I would now like to introduce our next speaker, and that is Dr. Shahala. So Dr. Shahala, I'm just going to share my screen here so you can see a little bit about her. This is Dr. Shahala Nadav. She has done her BHMS, her MD, FCHD, and her MS in counseling and psychotherapy. Her FCHD was her fellowship in homeopathic dermatology. And she did that in Dr. Batra. She has been a mentor as well for students who have passed out from the same place. She has been practicing for 20 years in Belgaum and enjoys being a family physician. She has also been a researcher, research coordinator, and assistant professor for PG students right after she had passed out. She has been an issue editor for NJH for 5 years. She has presented many papers on a variety of topics, including respiratory issues and on pediatrics. She has won many awards, especially from the Rotary Club in Belgaum. She has had many hobbies, especially music, gardening, and reading. She's also a keen runner and has competed in marathons. Dr. Shahala, we are eagerly looking forward to your presentation. I'm going to just highlight you now so everyone can see you and hear you. And whenever you're ready, Dr. Shahala, the floor is yours.
Good evening, dear all. Thank you, Dr. Anjali, for such a vivacious welcome and introduction. Overwhelming to say the least. It's a matter of immense pleasure and honor to be presenting on my very home turf, the Scintillating Saturdays with NGH. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. At the very outset, I take this opportunity to express my heartfelt gratitude to my dear teachers and mentors, Dr. Vishwala, Dr. N.L. Tiwari, Dr. Chandra Asrani, Dr. Rama Hariharan, Dr. Praveen, Dr. Bhaskar Bhatt, Dr. Ajit Kulkarni, Dr. Rajni Gwalini, and each and everyone. I will not keep on naming them because there are so many of us in our large and huge lovely family. So I thank each one of you for the support which propels me to aspire to be a better physician in general and a better homeopath in particular. Dear all, today I would be presenting 3 cases of skin ailments. As we all know, man is a composite being. We have the skeletal man, the muscular man, the arterial man, the nervous man, the venous man, and enclosing and protecting all this is the skin, that is the outer man. The outer man, just like how Dr. Rajni Gwalini just gave us so many huge and awesome tips on how to take care of skin, I would just like to go on the homeopathic aspect of it. The outer man is the one in whom we all take a greater or lesser pride. The one that receives the greatest amount of attention. The one that more pains are taken to beautify and adorn than all others. The one in which any imperfection is soon noticed and for which... Is it visible?
There we go. Perfect. Yes. Done.
I'll just resume. The outer man is the one... I was just talking to you about the outer man, that is the skin. The outer man is the one in which we all take a greater or lesser pride, the one that receives the greatest amount of attention, the one that more pains are taken to beautify and adorn than all other things, isn't it? The one in which an imperfection is soon noticed and for which relief is most promptly sought. If beauty lies in the eyes of the beholder, so does ugliness. So the treatment of skin ailments is of paramount importance, however small or innocuous the lesion may be. I would like to quote Dr. Chintanwala from his book on skin diseases. There are no skin diseases, especially this holds good for the homeopath, because there are no skin diseases. Majority of the disorders are on the skin and not off the skin. So here we go. I would like to present my first case, which is a very common nosological diagnosis which we encounter in our practice of acne vulgaris. So this is patient Ms. SP, age 28 years, a female patient. I would just like you to have a notice of this particular pics. This is how she came. And at the moment, the cystic acne have just erupted out. From last 2 years, she has been on various treatments before she came to me, and this was a skin condition. Before I actually talk about my case, in just few words, I would like to tell you what is acne vulgaris. It's basically a multifactorial self-limiting chronic inflammatory disease of the hyalur sebaceous cyst. We all know this unit, sorry. And is characterized by the blackheads and the whiteheads. Four major factors are involved in the pathogenesis of acne, though all the factors may not be present in one patient. So the four factors are increased sebum production, abnormal microbial flora, follicular wall and sebaceous duct hyperkeratinization leads to blockage and retention of sebum, and there's the inflammation of the lesion. This part of the grading of acne is a very important aspect when a patient comes to a clinic, basically because we can understand how we prognose this acne case when, and because most of the patients who come with acne or any skin disorder for that matter, they are always in a great state of anxiety, and the first question they tend to ask you is, how much will my acne be cured and will it be cured? So if I have a brief clinical idea about the grade of acne in my patients, at least I can guide them to what aspect I can help. And moreover, for me as a homeopath, it will be useful to grade my miasmatic cleavage in all the four types of acne. So we have the grade one called mild, which have only comedones and papules. Grade two is a moderate acne, which have papules, comedones and pustules. Grade three, pustules, nodules and abscesses. And grade four are the cysts, abscess and scars. If you have seen carefully my previous slide of my patient, it comes in the grade four category because she already has scars. She has undergone a lot of heat treatment, including peeling, and then she still has the growth of acne, which needs to be cured from within and not just the external application. So case in details, she has acne on the face since 1 or 2 years actually. The time she came to me, it was 1 year. Painful on touch, aggravated before menses, and she has no other particular concomitants. Past history, apoplectic disorder at the age of 20 years she suffered from. In family history, I did not find any significant family history. The whole case has taken me about 4 to 6 hours in different sittings, and then we have come upon the conclusion of what we call the remedy, which we'll be sharing soon. So in the life space, this patient hails from an upper middle class family, an agricultural family for that, and from a joint family. She has 3 sisters and she's the youngest of all the 4 sisters. The first 2 elder sisters are married out and well-to-do. The patient has had a good childhood, but the patient has always been an introvert from her school days, had few good friends, but would never express her innermost feelings even to them. Okay, so this is the type of closed compartment personality she was. She was irritable in her temperament, especially if things went against her, but she would not express it, would cry alone later on brooding over it. Especially her irritable temperament, I could notice it in her first visit to my chamber itself, because she was delayed for some reason because there was another patient in the, in my chamber or consulting there, and she was quite irritable, and my reception had to come and tell me, you please take her inside soon. So this irritability and other things, of course, in the entire case history, I did found it again and again repeating. She was always good in academics. Presently, completed her BA education. She has done her BA and is not doing anything in spite of her graduation. As a family, are looking out for her to get a good prospect for her marriage, along with the other sister. Basically, she's an introverted person. She has a brooding nature when alone, and of late, she says she has become highly irritable for trifles or for small things, especially before her menses. So I talked to her in detail about her premenstrual symptoms, because this was one very common cortical factor in the PCOS. Apart from the bloating and the acne presentation, she also had this severe mood swings before her menses. So in short, her mental genders, what I zeroed down to is, she is reserved, tearful, irritable, consolation aggravates her. She always prefers solitude, she enjoys solitude, and she likes to console herself. In her physical genders, we have thermals which are aggravated by warmth. She desires sour acids. She has aversion to fat or rich food, or pernicious food, what we call. So in every case, it's difficult initially to sit with the patient in front of you and start recognizing the case. I try to take at least a non-repertorial totality And that is what Dikto had tried to present in my slides today. So the non-referral totology, what I was framing in my mind when I was talking or after talking to my patient, was basically first a mental general, that is consolation aggravates her, brooding nature, depressed face, oily, shiny, acid greased. She feels better by open air, face is oily, shiny, acid greased, and acne are systemic. So this is the fourth grade of acne that I mentioned to you in the clinical presentation, if you remember the previous slide. Okay, the fourth grade is basically psychosyphilitic, because these cystic acne have generally happened because of the excess or fiddling with the acne, maybe with the chemicals or with the patient herself. And it's very difficult or impossible to treat once the cystic acne gets converted to scars. Plastic surgery is the only answer. Of course, Dr. Rajni has given us so many tips for this type of acne too, externally. We must try them out too. But speaking treatment-wise, homeopathic treatment-wise, cystic acne, this case is very important to me because it was a case of cystic acne and everybody had given off. Even the skin specialist says, you already have scars, nothing can be done. Her only aim was that let this acne stop coming and let my skin look better. Okay. And my aim was, she was such a depressed person. When I was talking to her, it was very, what you call, very bad, very sad to see her so sad just because of her acne. I wanted her to be all right mentally and physically. And so let's see how the results go about. So the repertory totality, that is later on when I took it, I've taken it mind reserve, consolation, aggravation, weeping, tearful, mood, alone when, irritability, menses before. This is, again, I would like to put two star marks. I have not put it on the slide. In general, warm aggravation, she has desire for sour acids. She has aversion to pernicious fat or rich food, what we call. And I've taken this particular rubric, pimples which are painful, skin is oily, which you can see in her pics all the time. So this is the repertory sheet. You can just have a glance. We have the first grade as Natremune, second one, Falstula, Phosphorus, Chamomilla, Belladonna, Calpheria. So many remedies, of course, as we repertorize each time we get. So just like, of course, we don't have a face-to-face this thing. So I'll go to the next slide and release my remedy. So Natremune 200 single dose was administered as a constitutional medicine based on repertorial and non-repertorial totality. Susceptibility of the patient was moderate, so medium potency and infrequent repetition. She was also advised to wash her face with mild soap and water and not to pick the lesions anymore as they lead to secondary infection and she already has the scars. At this point of time, I would like to tell you, I was very much sure it could be Falstula because like I just mentioned, when she walked into my clinic, the type of irritability that she was presenting was like Falstula. But over the course of 4 to 6 sittings, she would not open up to me so easily and with all the other symptoms repertorized. Okay, I came to the conclusion of Natremune and Falstula had to be taken as only as a differential diagnosis of the remedy. Tuja also was one of the remedies because her skin was really oily, shiny. She comes from a remote village from Belgaum, so she travels for almost 4 to 5 hours. So I thought it must be because of that. But then throughout, if you see, she has a very oily skin. But even Tuja is ruled out and the other aspects don't cover up in Tuja. So Natremune is the remedy. So just a quick follow-up. On 2/10/2018, that is the next follow-up, she came after a month. The acne are as it is. No new acne, even before menses. And that's what made her very delightful. She was very hopeful that homeopath is definitely going to help her. She said the previous ones are as it is. I don't mind about that. No new ones are coming. So pain in the acne had decreased a bit. Not much change in her mental generals because she had one cycle before she came to me. And she mentioned to me that the PMS things were as it is. So I just repeated because I didn't went through the case again, but I didn't want to change the medicine, not the potency, because there were slight changes. So I gave a Natremune 200 weekly one dose with Sac-Lac BD for 2 months because she wanted 2 months medicine. And then she said, if there's anything, she would keep in touch with me over the phone because she comes from a far off place. So she came on December 2nd, 2018, again, same year. So no new acne again. Previous acne have regressed much in size. I will show you the pics later on. incised, no known new lesion before the lenses. The patient expressed that she's feeling better emotionally too. And that's why I just repeated Sacylac BD for 2 months and no other medicine, no natural new was repeated. I'd already repeated 5 doses, if you remember the previous follow-up. And the patient reported again after 2 months, no new lesions. In general, the patient is fine. So this was one case which is quite satisfactory. So this is before the treatment, the first time that I've taken the pick. This is during the treatment, the old acne was as it is, but no new ones were coming. Just see the oily texture of the skin, which was a bit confusing with Tuja and the other remedy, Pulsetilla. And this is the present one. And she came with the good news this January 2020 that she has got a job and she's going to get married within 2 to 3 months. April 20th of this year, she'll be getting married. And the most important thing, what I would like to say is there are no skin diseases, like I already mentioned to you, majority of the diseases are on the skin and not on the skin. Okay. So basically the patient internally is feeling better. And that was a great achievement for me. And the patient was definitely happy because her acne have not come up till date. And that too, the 4th degree type of acne, which is cystic acne. And along with that, her PMS, her irritability, her mood swings, all have come to an end. Now I'd like to present my second case. I hope I'm audible.
Yes.
Yeah. So my second case is, the case for the previous case of natural mule may sound very simple and straight, but to tell you frankly, I have just coagulated all the facts and collated all the facts and put in front of you, and that's why the remedy looks easier. But it was a really a lot of mind-boggling thing when I had to go to the Matri Medica, because as usual we know that so many medicines can come, but this few points which I just mentioned, which I've taken to highlight in my case, came to the remedy of natural mule. The second case is another interesting case of molluscum contusion, a short case. Okay. And like we were just discussing, basically how homeopathy beautifies. It does not only treat from within, but it also beautifies the skin. And though we all know about molluscum contusion, they're also called as water warts. In short, a little bit clinical understanding of it, it's caused by the 4 types of molluscum virus, 1, 2, 3, and 4. And they commonly occur in children. They can occur in adolescents and adults too, but it may be readily transmitted in adolescents and adults. That's important. So the main causation is weak immune system, atopic dermatitis, crowded living conditions, other risk factors. In adults, we have it on the pubic, genitals, and perineal areas are favored. Most cases will clear up naturally within 2 years or 9 months. Okay, they start, like any other viral, what is the skin disorder, this is considered to be self-limiting, but then we cannot wait and we have to treat it because this can be transmitted to other people. So the molluscum looks like this, because I'll show you my own case next time. The clinical lesions are discrete, slightly shaped, dome-shaped papules that are fleshy or pink in color and 2 to 5 mm in diameter. And in children, the distribution is mainly on the trunk, face, extremities, and sometimes on the conjunctiva. I hope you can appreciate it because it is skin colored, but at least the second pick, please try to view it more carefully. You can find it all over the face. The mother of the child was very much agitated with this type of face the child has suddenly developed, and they keep on growing, you know. And so that is how they came for the treatment, and this is a pick before the treatment. Now sharing with you the details, she had it since 2 months when she came to me. There was mild itching. The lesions were discrete. You can see they were not in crops, papules and flesh color. In general, another thing is the skin aspect only. The patient was better by warm, uncovering, cold, warm, and she should wrap her head all the time. Because Belgaum is basically a cold place, we will find many people, what you call, being covered very well. But this child, she had come to me in quite a, not a very cold time of the season or the year. And she had come with a wrapped head that time also. I thought she just wore a bandana, so I thought she was just wearing it for fashion. But then she said, her mother said, she wear a cap or she will either wear a, what you call, any covering on her head, especially a scarf when she goes out, because she feels cold. The concomitants she had was a recurrent cold, ineffectual sneezing, fluent coryza. And the past history, she has history of febrile convulsions at the age of 1 year, but it has never recurred back again. She has recurrent cold and coryza since her infancy. The family history I could detect, she has, the mother has bleeding hemorrhoids, father has vitiligo and bursitis. He's on my treatment for bursitis and vitiligo. And the mental generals, what I understood about the patient was, she was a very mild child, desires to be magnetized. I said desire to be magnetized basically because she always wanted the assurance from her parents. She wanted the attention all the time, not your parents, even the doctor. When she used to come to me, she used to be all in this pink and white dress, like you can see it in the pictures. And she would want me without telling me. She would just look at me timidly and she expected me to say, you're looking very pretty, you're very nice and all the stuff. Because I heard it from her mother. Her mother said, doctor, she likes you very much because you keep on praising her. And that is how the situation will be every time. So I made it a point to see that she is what you call praised a bit, and then spoke to her so that she opens up to me. She's very mesh conscious. You can see it in the photographs later on. For the last visit, she was so happy and she was so thankful. She brought me a card and a flower. And she says, see, I look so pretty. She even wore a pink lipstick and came, you know. So very image conscious child, would get offended if she's reprimanded in the class or at home in presence of, especially of others. Like if the mother said, khati nahi hai kuch, if she told in front of me, she was very irritated. She said, how could you talk this about me in front of the doctor? How did you put this picture about me to her? She sticks to her own notions and ideas and does not, and though she does not express it vehemently, she always depends on her parents and younger sister for any work. In physical general, thermally, she is a high chili patient, and this perspiration of palms and soles and mild pitted perspiration. The mother said, not very bad. It is not that once she washes, it won't go away, but it's mild pitted perspiration. That is her physical general. And coming to the totality and reptile, again, like I told you, I did the non-reptile totality in my mind. That was mild nature, dependent nature, punctual. She was very punctual, even for appointments, wherever she goes, tendency to catch cold easily. And the reptile totality is basically mildness, pagnonized desires to be. She has an aversion to reading, and that's the problem with her. She can't sit for long hours and keep on reading. That could be a general complaint of the mothers to all the kids, but this particular child, we have actually evaluated properly and then come to this rubric. In general, cold aggravation, perspiration is profuse of palms and soles, recurrent cold, fluent coryza, ineffectual sneezing, and skin molluscum. So these are the repetitive totality I've taken and repertorize the case. So again, we have here, I think it's a bit smaller in size, but I hope you can appreciate that. Silicea, calcarea, phosphorus, all these remedies were coming up. She looked a bit like calcarea for, she looked a bit like silicea, but going by the thermal modalities and her timidity and her punctuality, and though she was a stubborn child, obstinate child, she would not express it vehemently. So all this led me to the conclusion of giving her or administering her this remedy. So Silicea 200C, one dose was administered on 12-11-2018, the day she came for the consultation, and called her after a month because, as we understand, she didn't have any other major problems except for cold and coryza. So there's no point in seeing such cases every week or every 15 days. So I called her after a month and just told the mother, if you have any problems, if the lesions get infected or something, please contact me immediately. So the patient came to next follow-up on 14-12-2018 after a month. No change in lesions. Actually, no change in lesions. But had a severe bout of cold with severe nasal obstruction. And she was, which is aggravated. The nasal obstruction gets aggravated in a warm room, though she in general is chilly patient. So that is a little peculiar symptom, which directly points us towards NASPOM 200, which Farrington has so beautifully explained in his comparative Metrimedica. He says that Luxworm has a cold, a very bad cold with nasal obstruction. But the moment the patient is in a warm room, he gets worse. Whereas Heppel cells, there is Silicea and all these remedies, it aggravated in open air. Okay. So, and luckily, when I refer to the Gibson Miller chart in Borith, Luxworm was what you call a complementary remedy to Silicea. So I just only prescribed the Luxworm 206, 200C, 6 hourly for 2 days. And no repetition of sedation. I just wanted, because sedation is deep acting medicine, because I somehow felt, or with the proper evaluation, in fact, I would not say somehow felt, it would look more unscientific, that sedation was a remedy and I should wait for some more time because of deep acting remedy too. So SLBD for a month was prescribed with SOS nurse formica. She came back again after a month. Two new lesions appeared on the chin, new ones. Older lesions were drier and smaller in size. One more tip I would like to suggest, when we see a case of molluscum contagiosum, the moment you see it shrink in size and even new ones are coming, okay, it means that these particular lesions are disappearing. The viral load is becoming definitely less in the skin. So that was one good point. So no severe episodes of cold after Nasform 200 or after the first dose of sedation, however we take it, it's a constitutional remedy. But one dose of sedation I did administer because she had two new lesions. And then again the next month, the lesions regressed in size. No new lesions, had a bout of cold and coryza, but she had taken Nasform 206 hourly from the stock that I had given her. No episode of cold after that treatment. Silesia 200C, one dose prescribed, mind you. This episodes of cold were recurrent right from a childhood. But this was one case which I really have learned a lot. A single dose, few doses, not a single dose of silesia could cure even her recurrent cold and coryza. That means the medicine has acted in depth and then the skin manifestation also has been cleared up from outside. So that is the beauty of homeopathy. That is how homeopathy beautifies our skin as well as treats the patient from within. We are treating the man in the disease and not the disease per se. Coming to the next follow-up, that was on 26/3/19, that is after a month again. The lesions have completely annihilated. Patient looks cheerful, was noticeably cheerful because she came with a card and all those things to me. No episodes of cold since a month. I have just prescribed the SL. But then since I've taken up this case for my study, I told her to meet me again after a month. Molluscum contagiosum, as you know, can be a recurring episode also with a small window period, unlike other skin disorders like psoriasis, where they have a long window period. And she did come to me after a few months, after 3 months, you can say. Patient in general is fine because she used to accompany her dad many times. I used to keep a tab on her skin all the time when she came with him because he's my patient basically. So, patient in general is fine, no episodes of cold, no recurrence of molluscum, and this is what homeopathy does. So this picture you've already seen, it was before the treatment. I've taken it on the mobile, I hope it's clear. And this is the treat, which is after treatment. Okay, very clear, very nice. And she'd come with all the makeup, her lipstick and a pink dress. So Sulisha 200C was given in infrequent repetition, moderate susceptibility, so 200C potency. Nasform 200C was prescribed as an acute medicine, which is a complementary medicine to Sulisha. On two occasions since she started treatment, that was approximately for 3 months. Okay, in the 3 months, we could help her to get annihilated of her molluscum. And she had two incessant sneezing and fluid coryza, and never after that. Okay, and the auxiliary measures which we had told, or we tell every molluscum patient, that hygiene has to be maintained. Don't share personal belongings because they're quite infective. Don't touch, pick, or scratch the lesions. I quickly go into the third case, which is basically psoriasis vulgaris. I've taken this case purposely to show psoriasis vulgaris is basically an autoimmune disorder, but the manifestations against skin. Again, I repeat the same thing, there are no skin diseases. The majority of the disorders are of the skin and not of the skin. And the best example is psoriasis. And I would take up the out of the 5 psoriasis that we have, I take up psoriasis vulgaris in this case. So this is the picture. This case remained with me for at least 3 years. So we had a window period in between. The lesions did not appear. But the patient, in fact, all the 3 cases what I'm presenting today, not a single pill of allopathy, no external applications. They're pure on homeopathy with few doses of homeopathy have recovered. So they are very dear cases in my kitty of so many skin disorders that I have in my practice. So this is the initial pick. Actually, he has clipped it in his own studio and said, and had brought me the pics when I requested him. So in short, a little bit about psoriasis vulgaris. It's a medical name. It's the most common form of psoriasis. Vulgaris basically means common. 80% people that we find in our clinics have psoriasis this time, that is the plaque psoriasis or the psoriasis vulgaris. They are well-defined plaques, raised skin that can appear on any area of skin. It can occur all over, unless guttate psoriasis, which occurs in droplets. It occurs on the front and the back of the chest. Then you have the scalp psoriasis, you have the palmoplantar psoriasis, which have a specific affinity to one particular area. But plaque psoriasis is one which can occur in a generalized form all over the body. So, but basically more on the knee, elbow, scalp, and trunk. These are the most common locations, though it can appear anywhere else. So the, if you see the picture, the flaky silvery, this is of course not the picture of a patient, but it is just to depict how plaque psoriasis looks like. We have the silvery scales composed of dead skin cells. The scales come loose, shed, and constantly form the plaques. Psoriasis varies in severity from small localized patches to complete body coverage. Injury to the skin can trigger psoriatic skin changes, which is known as Keebler's phenomena. The Keebler's phenomena, please keep in mind, because we also get Keebler's phenomena in warts, we also get in mollusca, and we get in psoriasis. It means that whenever there is an injury, in the particular line of the injury, you start getting those new lesions coming up there. And homeopathically, that is important for us. It's again a clinical hint that I need to put up, is that whenever we have Keebler's phenomena, it's one indication that we may need to give an intercurrent remedy at this point if I don't have any other symptoms and only skin symptoms are being manifested by the patient. Okay, so I just took up, I'm highlighting this Keebler's phenomena. Skin symptoms of psoriasis vulgaris include pain, itching, and cracking. It's a long-lasting autoimmune disorder, like I mentioned at the beginning, and characterized by patches of abnormal skin. So that's why I've taken up this case in skin section today. So the location on the entire body here, especially the anterior and posterior aspect of the chest, abdomen, arms, and legs since 5 years. He had dry, itchy skin. He told me the history that he had undergone so many treatments that he even went to the fish market and somebody told him, gather all the scales that this fisherman or the fish sellers, you know, people who sell the fish, throw it aside in their, they actually throw it away. So he used to gather it and apply it, just to be all stinking everywhere. For 3-4 days, his family members used to be away from him, you know. He had tried all that to get rid of it. And then he had come to homeopathy with hope. I would say not hope actually, because by his remedy, you come to know he was a bit skeptical even of taking homeopathy. But since one of his relatives, who is my patient, told him that you should go to this doctor and you should get homeopathy treated, he came to me. So he had this particular skin which was dry, itching aggravated on undressing was very, very common. So the moment I come back from my studio doctor and I take out my clothes, the itching starts. Till that, probably I'm busy, I don't understand it. But I've taken it as itching aggravated on dressing, which is a very good rubric that we have in our repertory. No other concomitants except this particular thing. Psoriatic, of course, lesions later on, after a prolonged time, do go to psoriatic arthritis and so many other complications. Psoriatic arthritis, the eyes get affected. But this particular patient at this moment is on this thing. And the beauty of this case, I would like to reveal now, is that there was no further progression of the lesions, neither did this autoimmune disorder progress in any way. And till date, he is hale and hearty. So past history, he has history of typhoid and malaria in early 20 years of age, when he was 20 years of age. And family history, the mother had aspartate disorder, she had hypothyroidism. And we checked him also for hypothyroidism because I think it's autoimmune disorder, but all these parameters were normal, except there was a mild, what you call, hypercholesterolemia. I mean, the cholesterol levels were a little higher, that was 250 or 260 around that time, but no, otherwise no other problems, neither diabetes nor hypertension. Okay, he had only this psoriatic patches which had come up. Father had early MI and had expired due to it. Paternal grandmother had psoriasis. So that's only one history that I could gather from his case history. In life space, this patient is an elderly person, hails from a very renowned joint family. His childhood has been uneventful and he has had no major emotional or physical activities throughout whatever case he was revealing. He has always been a mischievous person. If he starts a task, he has to complete it. So that's what he assured me. If I start a treatment, I will see that I will give the whole cooperation, but you must treat me. I will never give it halfway. Okay? And he's a very sympathetic person, very anxious person from childhood. He is into photography, naturally it was his profession, though he is retired from photography now. He just goes to studio sometimes and comes back. And he's into writing. He's a very good author. He writes poems and especially poems on social causes. He is sympathetic, very calm and sober person from his early youth. And this was one person, a lipo person, like, who used to be in the clinic with so much of sophistication, so sympathetic, a very nice person to even know in general. And he had mild anticipatory anxiety, not very much, but he would be anxious before public speaking because he was from a renowned family and he was a renowned person because he was a writer. He was called upon to speak many times outside, but he always told me, once I start speaking, I speak well, doctor. He used to speak in Marathi basically, but the starting is a big problem for me. And he used to have only anticipatory anxiety in public speaking. Since 5 years, he has been under stress due to business pressures because he has shifted his business of photography to his son. His skin lesions began around the same time, and he attributes to it. Of late, he has lack of confidence. He feels he's not able to cope with business trends because all the new trends in photography have come up. As he feels he's not able to cope up with business trends, he feels new projects cannot be taken by him. He feels lack of confidence. He always likes to be in company. One Dr. Vora, who is a MD physician, he's an allopath, was one more person who is to always encourage me, you're doing so well, you're committed, please carry on. His company, they're a group of people. So he always wanted this company. Daily evening, every single day, they used to meet up for the walk, have something from outside and come back. And this trait of his was the right from childhood. He always desired to, since he was in joint family earlier, he did not have the thing, but he always wanted to be in company. Or else he feels afraid and anxious. One friend does not come for walking, he's afraid and anxious and calls him up. What happened? Why didn't you come? Okay. He has developed a constant fear of breaking down under stress whenever he's alone. So that's one more reason he says, I always like to be surrounded by people. So in short, mental illness, want of self-confidence was very marked of late. Desire, company was one more important point. And a sympathetic person, because this we have seen it in so many times, even in a clinic. If an elderly person before him, though even he himself was an elderly person, he would say, let them go and show doctor and come, I will go next. Okay? In many ways, a sympathetic person, even the social causes for that matter. Physical generals, in general, ameliorated by open air. I've not noted down the whole thing, but the slides would increase. So I've just taken the positive point in the physical generals, and he was ameliorated by open air. Non-repetitive totality was constant fear of breaking down under stress, loss of self-confidence, averse to undertaking any new things, afraid to be alone at times, desired company, sympathetic, and psoriasis had violent itching. That was bothering him really very badly. So reported totalities, confidence, want of self-sympathetic, desire for company, desire sweets, open in emigration, psoriasis, dry, scaling, itching, and this was the most important point. Skin eruptions, itching and undressing, which I gave more emphasis to it because all other symptoms are so common to so many other remedies. So we have the repetitive chart here. This is a little bigger, I hope you can read. We have lipo, phosphorus, bryonia, natrimune, carbo-rich, arsenic, sapia, sulfur, calcarea, calicarb, and rustox. So the treatment given to this patient was basically lycopodium. 200 C was prescribed stat. After evaluating the case on repertorial and non-repertorial totality. Rustox 200C I have given as a phase remedy because if you refer Rustox, it is a follow-up of lycopodium or a complement, not follow-up, sorry, and a complementary, both in fact. And it was chosen as a phase remedy because whenever the exacerbation of this particular skin lesions came up, it acted very well as an acute remedy. And if you read up Rustox in Boric or in Farrington, and in Kent for that matter, you have Rustox as a remedy which is has very similar symptoms to plaque psoriasis, scaly eruptions which keep on forming and you keep on this thing, and this pinpoint, what you call blood release also, they are called pinpoint this thing, and kidneys phenomena also, if you just check out Rustox, if you scratch one thing, it gets duplicated on other parts. That is how Farrington has given this particular sentence, that the lesions keep on increasing more on aggravation after itching. The more the patient itches, the more the lesions increase. So Rustox is one of the acute remedy that I prescribed was Rustox based on symptom similarity and pathophysiology of the case. Another auxiliary measure that we advised to him was stop all that fish thing, and we stopped by so many what you call stinking things actually poorly. So stopped all that, just bath oil, bland soap substitute should be used if possible, like chana atta. Antiseptics should be avoided as they irritate the skin, because he had an allopath friend who said, okay, you take homeopathy, but you can apply local yam medicine. I told him, don't apply even those things. So relatively small localized patches that are there, we have to do some waterproof adhesive resin, which is not possible in vulgaris because they're so extensive. But the use of emulsions like coconut oil or the plain Vaseline, all these are good addictive treatments for psoriasis along with our internal medicines. Stress, smoking, alcohol abuse was told to stop. He was a smoker, but not a chronic smoker for that matter, just the last 3 or 4 years. And he was into alcohol, but only for social parties and stuff like that. So he was also prescribed dietary supplements of flaxseed, oily fish, rich in omega, because I needed to talk all this to him, basically because you understand that patient has been suffering so intensely that he has done so many things. And so this is an autoimmune disorder. So even the initial stages till our medicines act, even we are at a wit's end, we are also in a panic state, how will it improve? Because especially again, I told you, Belgaum is a place which is very cold, and all our winters, we have very bad aggravations of eczema, dermatitis, psoriasis, asthma, and even rheumatoid arthritis for that. So this is some of the tips that they given to him along with homeopathic medicine. So every 6 months I've taken a follow-up. I've written it down, in fact. I've taken it regularly every monthly. So to cut down the slides again. So we have, the patient came after 2 months of taking the prescribed medicine. He was prescribed Lycopodium 200 C weekly, one dose for a month. And there was considerable reduction in itching, but the lesions were very marked, especially on the lower limbs. The patient had mentioned that the lesions initially had begun on lower extremities and then appeared in the upper part of the body. He was further prescribed Lycopodium for 2 months, weekly one dose again. I didn't want to change the repetition nor this thing, because there was a consistent, what you call, other the lesions were remain as it is. Few new lesions I could observe, okay, in the initial few months. This is after 6 months that I have a second follow-up, which I put it down here. The patient had consistent improvement in his psoriasis throughout. The itching had reduced almost to nil. Even on undressing, now again I'm putting up this point very strongly, because I feel the first time that I took up this symptom was a very strong symptom, and that helped me throughout to understand how my patient is recovering. Even on undressing, which was a strong feature in this case. Initially he said, the moment I take out my case, the moment I go in the evening and take it out, or afternoon if I come for lunch and take out my clothes, it starts. So patient was on Lycopodium 200 monthly, one dose after this, from this date onwards. Then December, okay, this is the winter month, peak winter month. The patient reported with intensification of the lesions for a fortnight. And itching was too, had intensified very badly. But I didn't want to change the medicine, because again, the constitutional remedy, I just tried to, what we call, re-evaluate the case, but Lycopodium was a remedy. Neither did I want to go in a higher potency. Okay, so the patient was given Restorf, because he was actually met with 200 potency, was given Restorf at this point of time as an acute remedy for his symptoms of intense itching, redness of the lesions. Again, if you read up Restorf, redness of lesions is very marked with mild edema. I was a bit worried it should not land up into cellulitis, because the edema was quite obvious. He was prescribed SL for 2 more months with advice to call SOS or to use Restorf as and when required if lesions and itching become intolerable. In the next follow, the patient had no intensification of symptoms. It's not next follow, it's after 6 months. During this period, there was on and off. There was a window period also, the total totally fine. But mind you, he was not at all on any steroids, no other medicines, not even citrulline for itching, because his good friend is always telling, why do you want to suffer so much? Please take citrulline, we continue to homeopathy. But this patient, like he told, given me the word of the beginning, that if I stick on to you, that was his industriousness, I will stick on to this treatment. So, and that is a Lycopodium patient. Once we get his confidence, is very important. Because Lyco, it will be difficult to get the confidence initially, but once they will stick on to you. And he was basically a very sympathetic, mild person, and he wanted to please the doctor as well. Okay. So mentally, the patient was doing very well. Things had sort of settled down. Even though his son was not up to the mark, he was not in so much of an anxious state. He was very pleased with the anxiety getting better. That's what he mentioned to me. He said, "Atanga psoriasis ka chinta nahi hai. Tumhi mala bache anxiety bari zali mein kuch bhi gosh sangaichi hai." So that he was very happy. And so for us as a homeopath, this is the best thing that we can hear from a patient, that in general they're feeling better, their mental generals are getting better. So though the business situation was almost the same, his son was still not able to cope up after taking over. His daughter was married during this period, but the patient was pretty stable mentally. There were no anticipated anxiety. He could handle the whole marriage process very nicely. So 10, 12, 2016, after a few days, again, we had the patient had a minor flare-up of the lesions of the ankles. I will show you the pic. two doses of Estrox again settled the episode. The patient was prescribed lycopodium-1, and here I felt, let me see. I mean, because 220 of dose of depotection was there, and the patient was almost a stethoscope. And SL for the entire 6 months, he was followed up bi-monthly. He would come in soon, though I'd given him SL for those months. And then no new lesions, 6/6/17, that's after 2 years almost. All lesions completely annihilated. The patient in general is doing well till date. The patient was on SL throughout. In fact, he was one patient who carried loads of arsenic from me, though I told him this is not a prophylactic. We just give it on allergenous epidermal. He said, no, I would like to, because I'm doing so well, I would like to give to all my studio people. So he came during COVID in the month of somewhere around June once and picked up this medicine. Now the patient was asked to report to follow-up, no exaggeration on 2017, this is, I'm talking the previous follow-up. He came to meet me in 2020 and till now no episodes are there. Neither any, what you call, prognosis and psoriasis in terms of his joint pains or anything for that matter. The patient was asked to report and no exaggeration in the winter, though the winter was very harsh this year, 2017 that is. He had some ongoing stress at the domestic front, but his condition was stable. There was immense reduction in anxiety, and that was again, he told me, this is what I'm so happy after your treatment. And he was confident enough in handling many issues without much effort. He was all praised for homeopathy. In general, the patient is fine till date. So this is few pics I'm just putting up here. So this one I've already showed to you, which he had got me the first visit. I told him to get them. This is during the treatment. This lesions, whenever they appeared, at this time, I'd given him what you call Restox as an acute or phase remedy, what you call it. And this is after treatment. The lesions are completely annihilated. His skin looks much better, but somehow I could not take his pick this time. Hopefully, I'd take it next time when he comes to meet me. So the learning of the whole thing is, a well-chosen remedy can do wonders homeopathically, because the inner feeling, despite the outer circumstances not being any different than they were before the remedy, our state of mind makes all the differences in how we experience and interpret our life. And such turnarounds are great illustrations of how fundamental the state of mind is in creating either a state of health or a state of disease. A homeopathic testimonial, a learning on how homeopathy works beyond material conception. Though we take skin as an outer organ, just an appearance on the outer surface, but the internal harmony has to be set into order again, and only then the external thing disappears. So I hope I finished the